Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Following advice issued by Parliament authorities last month, this meeting will be held virtually. Our first item of business is a decision to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members content to take these items in private? Thank you. I'll move to the main item of business, which is an evidence session on the Subsidy Control Bill, which is a UK Parliament piece of legislation. The UK Parliament is seeking the consent of the Scottish Parliament as the bill has an impact on devolved matters and the executive competence of Scottish ministers. The bill was introduced to the House of Commons on the 30th of June 2021. Provisions in the bill apply to all of the UK. The bill is continuing its passage through Westminster and I understand is scheduled for the second reading in the Lords next Wednesday. So the purpose of the bill is to establish a domestic subsidy control regime for the UK following exit from the EU and provide a legal framework for public authorities to make subsidy decisions. The Scottish Government lodged a legislative consent motion on the 25th October, which has been referred to this committee to consider and report on. The Scottish Government does not recommend to the Scottish Parliament that it gives consent to the bill in its current form. And the purpose of today's session is for us to hear views on the provisions of the bill and its impacts in Scotland before taking evidence from the Scottish Government next week. Can I thank the witnesses for joining us today and welcome Professor David Bell, who is Chair of the Steering Group for the Replacement to the European Social Investment Funds in Scotland. Professor Stephen Fothergill from Sheffield Hallam University. Councillor Stephen Peddle, Environment and Economy Spokesperson, COSLA. And George Peretz, QC, Moncton Chambers. As always, can I ask members and witnesses to keep questions and answers as concise as possible. And thank you to all the witnesses for joining us this morning. Can I start with an initial question? Thank you for the written submissions that we received from people who are giving us evidence. I did notice, you know, you do talk about opportunities that are in the bill and the need for the bill to be introduced, but this seems to create a tension with the opportunities there might be in flexibility and with the need for authorities to have a degree of certainty. And I think, Mr. Peretz, you had talked about in your mission that there would be the bill, the changes would give us more flexibility and more speed and would give advantages, but at the same time it would be a challenge for authorities who might present risk aversion. There's a degree of uncertainty in how the system will work when we compare it to what we previously had within the EU subsidy regime. So, Mr. Peretz, if you maybe would like to go first and talk about where you see some of the opportunities, but where the tensions and the difficulties and how the subsidy regime would actually operate and what this would mean for those who are trying to work within it.
Good morning, everyone. I mean, I think the key difference between the two regimes is that under the old EU state aid regime, you essentially had a system that operated in practice that if you were granting a subsidy that fit within what were called general block exemption, particularly general block exemption regulation, but a couple of other ones as well, you could, provided you went through those regulations set out very sort of formal requirements for various types of subsidy, typically regulating the amounts, the percentage of the costs that were going to be met by the subsidy, the purpose of the subsidy, all sorts of other conditions. But provided your subsidy met those conditions, you simply got on with it. And the only sort of legal check you needed to do was to check that the formal requirements were satisfied. If you went outside those formal requirements in any way at all, then you were then subject to a typically fairly lengthy process of first of all persuading the United Kingdom government, because it had to be done through Whitehall, to notify the subsidy to the European Commission, and then you had to get the European Commission's approval, and that was a process that took effort and usually quite a lot of time. The current system, the system under the bill, works somewhat differently in that there is no Well, there are a few straightforward prohibitions on particular types of subsidy. We may discuss those. But in general, subsidies are permitted, provided that the authority has addressed its mind to and come to rational conclusions about various matters that are set out in the Schedule 1 of the bill, various principles. And the only challenge to that is by way of judicial review to the Competition Appeal Tribunal. Now, what that means is, I mean, and I think one can characterise perhaps the difference between the two systems in this way. The EU system was very good at dealing with routine subsidies, because all you needed to do is to check that what you were doing fitted within the terms of the block exemption regulations. It was not so good at dealing with anything that was novel or innovative or just fell outside the exemptions, because if you just fell out the exemptions or failed to notify, then your subsidy was unlawful. But in contrast, the new UK regime is much better at dealing with novel subsidies that are, on any view, almost certainly justified on the basis of public interest criteria, because it allows local authorities, public authorities, to look through and just take a sensible view of that. So much better at dealing with novel subsidies. But there is a problem in that if you're dealing with, if you're not sort of comfortable in dealing with that, there isn't a checkbox exercise you could do. You have to go through the thinking process. And in relation, and when you're thinking about particularly smaller public authorities or public authorities doing fairly routine grants, then that need to do a thinking process rather than just to check boxes means that the UK regime is perhaps less good at dealing with regular subsidies. Now, it's very important just to qualify that by saying that the subsidy control bill does contain a mechanism for what are called schemes and streamlined subsidy schemes, and those are created by it can be created by the Scottish Government, for example. They can be created by other types of public authority. Streamlined subsidy schemes can only be created by the UK government. But those schemes may well end up doing some of the job that the block exemptions did in the old EU regime, in that they will set out particular types of subsidy, and all the authority needs to do is to check that. But we wait to see what the schemes will be, because that's obviously not on the face of the bill. It will be a matter of, well, in the case of streamlined subsidy schemes, UK government policy in the relation and to other schemes, the policy of the devolved governments, UK government, and some other local authorities.
Thank you. Professor Fothergill, you also gave comment to the committee around some of the issues around uncertainty and the introduction of the new scheme. Do you want to comment on this line of questioning?
Yes, certainly. I think George Ferris's assessment is broadly correct, actually, we're moving from a system where there was some very hard-edged do's and don'ts in terms of what you could do in terms of routine subsidies anyway, through to a system where until we perhaps have some detail from the governments, from the UK government, which I suspect actually, we will not get as detailed a rule as we used to get from the EU, until we get some more rules, or whether if we don't, then we're living within a system whereby the organisation that wants to make the subsidy will have to judge its proposed subsidy against a set of principles, and that's obviously a rather more subjective process than judging proposed subsidy against some hard-edged criteria. Now, the problem is that most public sector bodies, and certainly the local authorities that I work closely with, are risk averse. They don't want to be offering a subsidy, perhaps even giving the money, only to find that they've done something which is out of order and is challenged, and they then have to reclaim the money, for example. So potentially, a lot of the players in this game We'll have to start hiring consultants and lawyers to, you know, make detailed assessments as to whether or not they can or cannot, you know, go ahead with a particular subsidy. And that's shifting the burden, if you like, you know, from central government or from what was the EU and its detailed rule setting. It's shifting the administrative burden, you know, from the central state, you know, onto individual players in this game. And I think that's going to be a real problem as we move forward.
Thank you. Councillor Heddle, mention has been made of local authorities. If you would like to come in, this was one thing for me. So compared to the previous system that we had with the EU, would a local authority typically be applying for EU subsidies? I understand it would go through the UK government, but is that a scheme that you were engaged in already? And do you see any opportunities in the new model, or do you share the concerns that have already been expressed? So that's for Councillor Heddle.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, I mean, obviously we would, as local authorities, would make use of subsidies through wider schemes, which were developed through our European partnerships in the various forms over the years, and would also benefit from direct application to structural funds programmes, particularly for infrastructure projects. Looking ahead to the new regime, yes, certainly there's opportunities in terms of the flexibility, as you outlined yourself, but these things are constrained by caution and capacity, as the two previous speakers have said. The capacity being to assess whether a new scheme is compliant with the principles, but not just the principles that are outlined and obviously will be elaborated on through guidance, but also the multitude of other trade arrange agreements that might be coming through, and indeed the WTO rules that apply to this. An expectation is on the public authorities to be aware of these things and to judge any subsidy that they provide against this multitude of constraints. So there is going to be capacity issues in authorities in being able to make this judgment, and this is inherently going to lead to caution. So our view in COSLIS that moving ahead, this caution, this how would you describe it best, the uncertainty, it would be best addressed through new statutory guidelines for specific sectors and areas, which would be not dissimilar to the grant block exemptions and the other block exemptions that have been applied in terms of agriculture and fisheries in the past, and that these guidelines need to be co-produced between the UK, the devolved and the local governments, to share both understanding and to make best use of the opportunities that we have. The other thing that can lead to uncertainty would be the use of the Bill's proposed UK ministerial discretion to call in a subsidy. And it would certainly be to our benefits if this was limited in some way, so that the use of the call-in would be predictable as we try to make our subsidies.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Heddle. You've highlighted some of the issues that other committee members will pick up on as we move through the meeting. But before I move on, I'll give Professor Bell the opportunity to respond to this additional area of questioning. If there's anything additional he would like to add.
I'm not an expert on how the block grant exemptions worked and so on, and so additional flexibility obviously would be welcome. The issue of uncertainty, though, and getting clearer guidance from the UK government does seem to me to be very important. And picking up on Stephen's point, when we discussed the replacement for the European structural funds, we came to the view that a lot of local authorities would have difficulty in terms of capacity for applying for structural fund grants. Some are well placed, others are struggle to keep on filling in forms and finding the right consultants and lawyers and affording the right consultants and lawyers. And we had come to the view that the regional economic partnerships should play an important role in bringing together economic development across different parts of Scotland. And it was disappointing that with the funds that have been released thus far, like the Community Renewal Fund and so on, the link has been direct from UK government to Scottish local authorities, in the sense that some of them just found the whole process of applying too costly, too time consuming, was not a worthwhile, not a cost effective exercise on their part. So what I guess I'm doing is that I'm reinforcing this idea that if you are going to go down to local authority level, the local authorities have to be very, very clear and incur minimal cost in putting together the appropriate documentation for subsidy application.
Thank you very much for replying to the first areas. I'll move on to Michelle Thompson, but other members will pick up on issues that have been raised so far.
Good morning, everybody. We've got quite a few submissions in about the potential impact on economic development. And I note yours, Professor Bell, about the difference between horizontal and vertical development that you point out in your submission. However, and it's perhaps a regret, we don't have a representative from the Scottish National Investment Bank on the panel this morning, which you'll be aware is a £2 billion investment over 10 years from the Scottish Government. So it's a serious amount of public money. Now, they make clear, if you allow me just to check in their submission, their concerns that fundamentally, and I quote, "It goes without saying that if development banks are to be constrained to operating in areas of market failure, the new UK subsidy control regime must be at least as wide as its predecessor and offer sufficient discretion to public bodies and devolved administrations." So I wanted to get your views on the Scottish National Investment Bank in particular, in that it seems to be a slightly different model, given that it was specifically set up to aid economic development in Scotland in a pretty key way, not least of all net zero. But I imagine it's also, if this is the case for the SNB, it's also an issue for the British Business Bank, for example. So perhaps Professor Fothergill or Professor Bell might like to answer that question first of all.
Yeah. Shall I start off?
Yes, thank you, Professor Bell.
Yeah, I mean, so this occurred to me while I was writing my piece, that it's certainly not clear to me how the Scottish National Investment Bank will interact with Competitions and Markets Authority as far as investment, particularly, and I do mention in my paper the net zero ambition. So it seems to me that this is one of the several areas that are kind of left hanging without, and there needs to be some clarity. And as you, since you mentioned the British Business Bank as well, that will be necessary for, I guess, the UK as a whole, because it will have to know how its activities may be affected by this new bill. I don't know exactly how this will pan out, but it seems to me that, you know, there's a sort of trade-off here about controlling state aid and other objectives that the UK and Scottish governments may have. And I don't know whether these, maybe George knows whether anything like this has would impact on how the trade and cooperation agreement.
And just before somebody else comes in, could you see that could have a cooling off effect for the Scottish National Investment Bank if they are fundamentally constrained to just market failure? From a risk perspective, obviously their risk assessments will be tightly honed given the nature of what they're doing.
Well, Steve Fothergill said, you know, there will be lots of consultants and lawyers employed to determine what exactly a market failure is, although there are also distributional issues that can be raised. But nevertheless, if there is a lack of clarity around these, then as other speakers have said, risk aversion may be the watchword the relevant bodies will not take schemes forward that they would have otherwise done.
And I can see George Peretz wants to come in at this point.
Yeah, I mean, it seems, I think the way of thinking about it is this. I mean, I'm afraid I'm not familiar with the details of the Scottish National Investment Bank, but you know, any public authority which has got grant-giving powers, what it's going to have to do within the framework of the bill is it's going to have to think about the proposal. Let's take the proposal is to give a particular company a tranche of money for training purposes or some other, you know, research and development. What it's then got to do is it's got to look through the principles, and those will require it to ask of itself questions such as, is this money going to be paying for something that would have been done anyway, in which case it's unlikely to go through the principles. Is it going to distort competition? Is it going to have effects on other businesses that outweigh the benefits that it's going to produce? Is it value for money in a broad sense? Are there less expensive ways of achieving the objective of making sure that people are properly trained? And so all those questions fit one way or another within the scope of the principles, and that's what the Scottish National Bank would have to address its mind to. Now, what's different under the new regime is that it, unless the particular proposal fell within a scheme, which might be set out by the Scottish government, for example, or a streamlined subsidy scheme, which would be set out by the UK government, then the bank would have to go through that process. Whereas under the old regime, it might have been able to say, this is a training aid that fits within the scope of the training aid exemption in the general block exemption regulation. It ticks all the boxes. We don't actually have to think in any sort of wider sense about what the the way in which these general principles apply to this particular aid. Now, as various commentators have made, the one problem with saying to local authorities or authorities such as the Scottish National Investment Bank that you have to think about this problem for yourselves, and in one sense is liberating, that you're saying you reach this assessment, and provided it's a reasonable view, you're going to be soundly based and immune to judicial review, you're going to be able to do it. So on the one level, it's sort of quite liberating. You don't have to get somebody sitting in Brussels to approve it. On the other hand, it's also quite, in a sense, quite alarming, because that's a process of reasoning that some authorities are not particularly comfortable with doing. And there may be a demand for expert economists, consultants of various kinds, lawyers, I'm afraid, to help guide them through that process. So, you know, there are pluses and minuses.
And how do you think we've ended up in the position where it's going to second reading later this month, I think next week, and yet we still don't have this level of definition, and it could potentially go all the way through, and what's proposed at the moment is that it's left to Bays to make the decisions. Therefore, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but it seems to have the potential for bypassing ministers and UK government, never mind the Scottish Parliament altogether. How on earth have we ended up in this position?
Well, I mean, there is quite a lot of detail going to be filled in. It is also true, and you know, that we can perhaps discuss this later, that the role of the devolved governments in that process is in some ways unsatisfactory. You know, I've written about that. I'm sure it's a matter of interest to the committee. I mean, what's actually going to matter on the ground, I think, for, you know, a body such as the Scottish National Investment Bank or a Scottish local authority, is going to be whether there are schemes or streamlined subsidy schemes that cover what they want to do. And that is just an unknown, because what the bill does is it just gives power to the UK government, and in relation to schemes also to the devolved governments, to make schemes. And we've got to wait and see what the schemes are and what they look like. The schemes themselves have got to comply with the principles. So, I mean, take an example, it would be open to the Scottish government to say it would be good to have a scheme for the granting of subsidies for training purposes for certain types of training in Scotland. And you can imagine a scheme, and there would be some form of framework that would be set out, which said local authorities in Scotland may grant, under the scheme, may make the following types of subsidy awards that tick the following boxes. And that scheme itself could be subject to challenge in the Competition Appeal Tribunal, and the scheme itself would have to be thought through in accordance with the principles. Are we satisfied that the sorts of grants that are going to be given under the scheme are necessary, that they don't duplicate what companies would already have done in terms of training their workers? Various other things. Is it going to distort competition in ways that are unacceptable? Is there a less expensive way of doing this that wouldn't require the expenditure of so much public money? That sort of thinking process, which, to be frank, is the sort of thinking process that should be done anyway, because obviously it's good public policy to be satisfied that you're spending public money in a way, in the most efficient way possible. So a lot of this is stuff that people should be doing anyway. But you've got to think that through that in a reasonably structured way. And then you might end up with a Scottish government scheme that all Scottish local authorities could simply look up when they were thinking about giving grants to companies to train workers, and if it ticked those boxes, they could give it. And that would be within the control of the Scottish government. So the bill provides a framework for things to be done.
Yeah, but I guess where we started with this, because I'm keen that other people in the panel have the chance to come in as well, the detail to establish a scheme needs to be in place first and foremost. And it appears that the detail, whether specifically for the Scottish National Investment Bank, in its kind of role of market failure and beyond, is not yet clearly established. Just before, because I'm aware that other people need to come in, Professor Fothergill, was there anything, or indeed anybody else, Mr. Heddle, if you wanted to come in just on this comment about the Scottish National Investment Bank before I give way to other members?
No. Yes, could
thank
I come in on this, please?
Yes, thank you.
Firstly, can I just clarify where we are in terms of the legislative process down in Westminster? My understanding is that this bill has received its third reading in the Commons, which means effectively that it's been passed, though of course it's got to work through the House of Lords. There may be some amendments, but you know, with the sort of majority that the government has in the Commons, I think what we're looking at now is an almost finished Act of Parliament. Now, that being the case, the lack of detail in the bill is very worrying, because a lot does hang on you know, the detailed guidance that ministers will issue, no doubt, as statutory instruments. And I think it's important to impress upon the Westminster government, that before all of that guidance is finalised, it should put it out consultation. So, you know, these would be the detailed rules that would circumscribe, you know, what the Scottish Investment Bank and many other players could or couldn't do. But, you know, it's not defined carefully in the bill, and it's a big leap from where we are in the bill, almost the Act, you know, through to, you know, some final rules, you know, being issued by ministers. There's far too much arbitrary discretion there without consultation, not just with the devolved administrations, but with a wide range of interested players. And I think it's important that the Scottish Government, you know, impresses upon Westminster that, you know, there should be a draft issued, you know, for consultation on all of these points. Thank you.
Yeah, and I did notice when you appeared in front of the Bill Committee in Westminster, you stated, and I quote, from the point of view of the devolved administrations, for example, the passage of the bill will still leave them pretty much in the dark as to what they can and cannot do. So that was the 26th of October. Do you still stand by that observation you made at that point?
Absolutely, I do. In fact, if anything, the discussions, albeit brief, that I've had with civil servants since that point in time, you know, worry me even more, because I do think they're a little bit wedded down in London to saying, here are the principles and get on with the job, which is really not enough. And though they're talking of issuing at least some guidelines, you know, the wording that I've picked up is that, oh, well, there won't be anything as detailed as you know, the old EU rules, and it's all very worrying. So, you know, there will be guidelines, possibly without consultation and with inadequate detail attached to them. So the more pressure that's put on Westminster and Whitehall to be participative in this game, you know, to be open and seek views, the better I think the end outcome will be.
Thank you. I was going to move on to Maggie Chapman, and Maggie does have questions around consultation. And I understand that Mr. Heddle would like to come in, but I'm sure Ms. Chapman will invite him to speak.
Thanks very much, Kay. Good morning to the panel, and thank you for joining us. Yeah, if I can just follow on that theme of consultation and exploring a little bit more from your different perspectives, not only what needs consulted on, but actually who should be the key players. Obviously, you know, we know that the Scottish Government has a clear interest here, but so do local authorities. Can I bring Stephen in? You said you wanted to respond to that point earlier. But in one of your earlier comments, you talked about co-production of the rules and guidelines. Can you just unpick that a little bit more and maybe give us a better understanding of exactly who should be the co-producing players in that, and what do we need to do to make sure that we get that as clear as possible? So it's Stephen Heddle first, if that's okay.
Yeah, thanks very much. I've just organised my voluminous notes here. I mean, I suppose this very much follow on from the points made by the previous speakers in response to the last question around the adequacy of the current consultation and how the gaps in guidance are going to be filled in. Certainly, the amendment that Costless produced is, you know, it's deliberately specific and limited in the hope that it can be accepted. But it specifies that we feel that the devolved administrations, local government, and the other persons that the Secretary of State should be fit should be consulted. I mean, we're coming from a position where, under the European state aids rules, the development of any changes were subject to extensive consultation, and there were statutory mechanisms in place that involved local government as well, particularly through the Committee of the Regions. And we would hope that any arrangements that would be made in respect of the subsidy control bill and the way it's enacted would be no worse than the previous arrangements. Indeed, in 2018, local government was given an undertaking that the consultative mechanism that would involve us would be set up, and we're still waiting to see this happen. Just thinking about the kind of the wider issues that's here. I think the issue of the common frameworks and how they play into this hasn't been developed in the conversation so far. Would certainly be keen to see more use made of this. I mean, there is a hope that this is a development field, and we've seen it happening so far in procurement and air quality, waste. And you know, this is welcome, but the thing that's not welcome is the absence of involvement in local government in this, because some of these areas are where essentially our devolved competences and where it falls upon us to deliver the change and I would imagine the subsidies related to that. So I mean the system as it stands is not good. We need to beef this up in terms of the involvement of the devolved administrations. We need to beef it up in terms of local government, and then beyond to the other public bodies, because the issues raised earlier by the Scottish National Investment Bank, which we hoped was going to be key to delivering our climate ambition, which is the point that was raised by Professor Bell. I mean, these are equally valid. So. The situation as it stands is completely unformalised in terms of the consultation. We would appreciate some formalism to it so that we know it's definitely going to happen and not just be in the gift of personalities. And you know, that's essentially the substance behind two of our amendments as proposed.
Thanks very much, Stephen. That's really helpful. I know David wants to come in, and I'm happy to hear from David. I wonder if I can pick up something you said earlier, David, though, and maybe you can address this point as well. You spoke about, in relation to Michelle Thompson's questions around SNB, and specifically, and Stephen mentioned this as well, with respect to strategic decisions around net zero ambitions, those kinds of things. Can you tease out for us a little bit about how we can, what it is we need to do to make sure that we can actually get the legislation we need that is flexible enough, open enough, that allows us to make the regional or local strategic decisions that we need to make around industrial strategy, that never mind anything else. So David, to you.
Yeah. So, I mean, it seems to me that it's not immediately obvious how net zero or ambitions towards net zero and the sort of industrial implications thereof marry up with the principles that George has mentioned by which whatever schemes are eventually arrived at are going to be made. So there's there is an issue which really does need to be one of the very important issues that it would be good for the Scottish Government to seek clarity on with the UK government about the way that the principles and the UK government's own ambitions towards net zero can be compatible. As everyone else has said, there's a lot that is not said in the current drafting. The other point that I would make, following on from Stephen, who I was involved with in terms of extensive consultation that we did around the replacement for the European structural funds prior to the prior to nothing much, because the UK government has still to kind of specify where that particular train is actually going to go. But in addition, we've mentioned SNIB, we've mentioned the local authorities, but it's also true that in many ways, the economic development structure in Scotland is different from that in the rest of, well, in England in particular. And I would mention, for example, the development agencies, which we haven't mentioned, and they'll be uncertain about what their role will be going forward. And also Skills Development Scotland, who obviously have a big role in providing training. In our consultations, we heavily involved the SCVO as well, and they were heavily involved with the previous EU funding regimes. Now, but how that may or may not, how their activities may or may not interact with state aid rules is not clear. But these are the kinds of bodies that should be being consulted, it seems to me, as well as the obvious candidates, the local authorities, NIB, and so on.
Thanks, David. That's really helpful. I wonder if I can move on and linked to this. I suppose one of the gaps that I think one of the maybe many gaps that there is, and I might have missed it, but there doesn't seem to be any way of dealing with dispute. Any ISDS equivalent or sort of interregional way of dealing with dispute, and I wonder if maybe Steve Fothergill, if you had anything that you wanted to say on that, and how we draw voices in around that to ensure we get dispute mechanisms, we get a way of dealing with technical and strategic issues in the space.
Well, when you're referring to dispute, I thought at first you were meaning that you know, that one part of Britain might contest what another part of Britain might do. I mean, certainly one of the principles that the government has set out is you know, any subsidies should not be damaging to the, you know, the coherence of the internal market. So, you know, what they're trying to stop there, and I think they've got a point actually here, is the game of subsidy races between different parts of the UK. I mean, they don't want a situation where, you know, Scotland puts in a bid, offers certain amounts of money, Wales then offers more, England comes back with even more, and Scotland has to offer even more money. So certainly everybody in this game will have to look over their shoulder at that seventh principle in the list, which is about avoiding subsidy races. But the real worry about disputes, I think, is the one I was trying to get at a little bit earlier, which is that, you know, from the point of view of a risk-averse public body, you know, they will not want to be challenged on their actions. You know, in fairness, under the old EU regime, The general block exemption regulations, you know, covered the vast majority of the subsidies that were made available by all sorts of public bodies to private sector companies, and therefore there was no dispute, you know, if you were within the rules. But in the absence of something similar, the door is left open to dispute. So there are perhaps two levels to this. I mean, I can, you know, definitely we don't want the subsidy races, but it's the disputes on individual awards being contested that I think is a real worry here.
Thanks very much for that. Thank you, Claire. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. I'll now bring in Fiona Hislop, who will be followed by Alexander Brennan.
To the panel. Clearly, our committee's responsibility is actually to decide whether we want to recommend approval of legislative consent. So, despite the fact the bill is so far down the line, this is obviously of importance to all of us in the Parliament. There's three specific points here. The block exemption is to be replaced by streamlined subsidy schemes, which the Scottish Government is not going to be involved in establishing. If there was co-production in that, does the panel agree that actually some of these disputes could be removed? Secondly, disputes, as we've heard, could be within the UK between governments trying to subsidise particular projects. And again, we need some common way, potentially common frameworks, of setting the rules of the game to minimise those disputes. But again, is that is there anything in the bill that allows for that now? My understanding is no, so therefore it needs guidance that hasn't even been published yet. And then thirdly, and perhaps this is for George Peretz in particular, and perhaps Professor Fothergill, is individuals or individual companies taking judicial review decisions, and what difference would the proposed scheme make to them? Does it make it easier or more difficult for individual companies who feel that they've been disadvantaged from a competition point of view? So those three areas, should Scotland be involved in the streamlined subsidy schemes? Is there a way of ensuring that the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament can be involved in that inter-geographical administration dispute, and call in powers to the Scottish Government, maybe a way of allowing that in a similar way to Bayes? And then thirdly, about that individual companies deciding that they want to take something to judicial review, does this new scheme give them more advantage or disadvantage compared to the European setup? So first we can maybe come to Professor Peretz and then to Professor Fothergill, and if the other panellists may want to indicate if they want to come in on that.
Yeah, I'm not a professor. That's sort of distinguished status as the other ones.
Apologies.
Yeah, let me take those three questions. I mean, on your question on the Scottish Government's role in streamlined subsidy schemes, I mean, I think 2 points. I mean, first, it's important to distinguish between, there are two types of scheme set out in the bill. That's what we might call just ordinary subsidy schemes, which the Scottish Government does have power to do, and indeed some local authorities have power to do, as well as the UK government. And that has the effect that we were talking about earlier in terms of it provides a framework within which other authorities or the Scottish Government itself can then go on to make sort of particular awards that fit under a particular framework. So that's something that the Scottish Government can do. What it can't do is streamline subsidy schemes, which are particular category of schemes. So you ask, and that can only be done by the UK government, and it has to place the scheme before the Westminster Parliament, but that's all done down in London. What's the difference between a streamlined scheme and an ordinary scheme? The essential difference is the streamlined scheme doesn't ever have to go through the Competition and Market Authority process, whereas an ordinary scheme may need to go through that process, depending on what the, you know, what the size of it is. So that's the critical difference. Now, as to the question as to whether the Scottish Government or the, and presumably also you would say the Welsh Government and the Northern Irish Government would have power it themselves to make streamlined subsidy schemes, well, obviously that's a political question. The government's position on that is to say, well, actually subsidy control is a reserved matter in relation to all the devolved legislatures, therefore it's appropriate for Westminster only to have that competence, but that's ultimately a political question. Your second question was how do disputes between governments work here? One can sort of posit the idea that there might be a subsidy given by the Scottish government that the Welsh government didn't like very much, take that example, thought would have adverse effects in Wales. What could the Welsh government do about that? There's a number of possibilities. It may be that the type of award was one that was capable of being either had to be sent to the CMA, in which case there would be discussion presumably in front of the CMA. It might be something that could be referred by the Secretary of State to the CMA, in which case the Welsh Government would have to go to the Secretary of State and say, we're really concerned by what the Scottish Government is doing. Would you like to send it to the CMA, please? And the Secretary of State could then do that. The CMA, of course, doesn't, under the bill, doesn't itself decide, but it issues a report on the compatibility of the proposed measure with the principles. And the way in which the, taking my example, the Scottish Government has gone through the process. And its report is likely to be highly influential. It would be quite a courageous decision, but in most circumstances, by a public authority to go ahead with the grant, even when the CMA had strongly thought that it wasn't justified. But it, in principle, it might be it were open to do it, but it might in practice be quite brave. So that's one way in which you might have a dispute. It may be that the Welsh Government, you know, that process wasn't gone through, the Welsh Government, the award was about to be given, the Welsh Government could then apply to the Competition Appeal Tribunal for judicial review. Now, when I wrote my article, which I sent a link to, it wasn't at that stage at all clear to me that the devolved governments, or indeed any sub-national authority, local authorities, would actually have standing to bring challenges to the Competition Appeal Tribunal because of the definition of interested party in Clause 70. Now, as the bill's gone through Parliament, the Minister has made it very clear that that definition is not intended to be narrower than the usual definition of who has standing in public law cases, which may be slightly different in Scotland from what it is in England, but is fairly broad. And he specifically said that local authorities and devolved governments would have standing to challenge decisions of other public authorities if they were concerned that it would have effects in their area. So the Welsh Government would have standing if it could demonstrate that it was concerned about effects on businesses in Wales. So that, I think, has put those concerns somewhat to one side. So that's another way in which disputes might be resolved. And now that brings me sort of to individuals, because that process of challenge in the Competition Appeal Tribunal is also one that's open to individuals as well, who are concerned that an award may have been given, which simply does not comply with the subject control principles. Now, that is, it's important to emphasize this is a judicial review challenge. So the question isn't, has the public authority got, you know, got something wrong, just got a policy decision wrong. The question is, has it gone beyond what is a reasonable decision for a public body to make? So you're looking for a fundamental error in reasoning, something that simply cannot possibly be right, no matter what view you take, or an error of law, or the other sort of basic grounds for or an error in procedure, the basic grounds for judicial review. So, you know, it wouldn't be enough simply to say we disagree with what, take my example of the Welsh Government or a private party challenging a decision of the Scottish Government to grant a subsidy. It wouldn't be enough for them to say we just disagree with that. We think that the principles should have been interpreted so as to forbid this award. On the contrary, it would be necessary to say actually the reasoning of the Scottish Government here just doesn't stack up. There's some sort of error, really fundamental error here. Quite how the CAT is going to approach that task is going to be quite interesting. The CAT has tended to take quite a sort of stand-off approach, hands-off approach, to reviewing decisions by regulators on technical matters of competition regulation, such as on merger control, for example, because it's dealing with impartial regulators. I mean, the difference here is going to be the CAT is going to be told by anybody appealing that, you know, there were enormous political pressures that the appellant will almost inevitably say for the authority to find that the principles were satisfied in this particular case. The politicians were telling it, you were saying this is something they really wanted to do. It's, you know, public authorities granting aid are not really like impartial regulators. They are quite rightly and obviously political bodies with political agendas, and quite how the CAT will approach its task, I think, is going to be quite interesting. Sorry, that was, I asked three questions and I tried to answer them all. But
yeah, thank you very much. And of course, Bayes is in the same position because they end up being judge, jury and also subsidiser. Can we also bring in Professor Fothergill in this? And I'd quite like to hear from Professor Bell in relation to net zero and agriculture and what the implications might be because they are devolved competencies. So, Professor Fothergill, please.
Okay, thanks. And Fiona, can I try to answer your three questions with two answers? that actually really apply to all three of the questions that you posed. I think at the core of all of this, avert, avoid, minimise disputes, we need guidance and we need detailed guidance. The second answer is that we also need consultation on the guidance. Now, I say consultation rather than co-decision making, and I know that is probably a little touchy in the context of the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament, but I think in practice, given that there are so many players in this game, who would have an interest in the final rules, that there is a question of where you draw the line in terms of who would be brought in if it was co-decision making. I mean, do we have to get agreement amongst all the four nations of the UK? What about the local authority players beyond the devolved national administrations, etc., etc.? So I think meaningful consultation, and meaningful consultation actually, of course, requires that that Westminster and Whitehall is genuinely wanting to listen to what everybody is saying from around the country. I mean, under the old EU state aid rules, there was a lot of consultation. I mean, the EU consulted on establishing the rules, and further down the line, I mean, in the context of regional investment aid, for example, the UK government consulted on drawing up an assisted area map, and consulted even on a drafted assisted area map. And through consultation, you do, in practice, tend to work towards something which carries everybody with you. And the combination of the consultation and the detailed guidance should head off a lot of the disputes.
Yes, thank you. And if I can come to Professor Bell, clearly, in terms of the decision to include agriculture in this subsidy, when there's been this subsidy control, when previously it's been separate, clearly, agricultural subsidy is a devolved matter. The subsidy control bill is a result of Brexit, but I don't think even supporters of Brexit would necessarily think that Brexit should remove or limit and reduce powers of devolution. So, what are your thoughts about the implication for that, particularly when the nature of Scotland's agriculture is quite distinct, so therefore we need particular subsidies? And also on net zero, we heard from local authorities yesterday in the Net Zero Committee that they will have to, and it's essential that private funding at scale will be needed along with public funding to tackle net zero. And clearly, in terms of net zero, that would require a streamlined subsidy scheme, surely, because to tackle the climate emergency, state subsidy will have to be swift, it will have to be smart, and it will also have to be strategic. So does this subsidy control bill lend itself to good policy making and good results in the years of agriculture and net zero from your experience with devolution over this period?
So I think I would kind of just echo what Steve Fothergill said, that in a sense, we've got stuff in here that is not really clearly enough defined yet, and that we need to engage, or it would be desirable if we engaged in a sequence of meaningful consultations with the UK government around and or BEIS around what this is all going or how this is all going to play out in practice. I was quite surprised that agriculture was included, and it does seem to me that that in England and Scotland, the subsidy schemes for agriculture are going in different directions. Neither of them are entirely clear as yet. In England, clearly the public money or public goods approach is meeting with some resistance and some significant debate about how it might change the nature of agriculture in England, and I guess we don't know yet what will happen in Scotland, but there are, as you say, significant differences in that agriculture plays an important social role, our remote rural areas, and whether funding schemes that don't necessarily have a public goods aspect to them would run into difficulties with the bill as currently laid out is not clear, because we haven't had this consultation or the further detail on the scheme. And the same sort of applies to net zero. While you do not want to encourage a subsidy races between different parts of the UK in terms of getting the say the renewable sector up and running, it is, as you say, pretty likely that there will have to be some injection of public funds into the sector to make it or to encourage change at speed. And then I mean, we basically have to know how that can be done within this particular bill and how it is actually going to play out in practice. We just don't have enough detail yet, or we don't know how a streamlined scheme might be devised that would meet both the principles included in the bill and at the same time the objective of getting to net zero as quickly as possible.
Thank you very much, Professor Bell. I think I should hand back to the convener for time-wise, but if Councillor Heddle has any comments on this, hopefully he might be able to bring them in answers to some of my colleagues. So, convener, I think I should hand back to you now.
Thank you, Ms Heslop. I'll now bring in Alexander Burnett, who'll be followed by Colin Beattie.
If I could ask
members, I know it's unfortunate for the members to come later in the meeting, but if I could ask members to be concise in their questions, that would be helpful. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, convener. Apologies to the panel for taking you back to the beginning of the meeting. My question was a supplementary to the first one. Yeah, there appears to be a consensus that the rules on state aid proposed, as they currently are an improvement on the previous rules, obviously notwithstanding any further improvements that could be made. But if I could ask two questions, the first to Stephen Heddle. In the COSLA submission, you say that the previous EU regime could have a lowest common denominator effect, which sometimes constrain public funding. I just wondered, could you explain a bit more about that and give an example, and whether that is being that effect, that negative effect, has been removed under the current proposals? And for the second question, to Professor Fothergill, and echoing Fiona Hislop's comments around the purpose of this session, Professor Fothergill, you say that the alternative would be an unhelpful three-for-all. Could you maybe just explain what the impact would be of not signing up to the scheme? Thank you. So, Stephen Heddle first.
Thanks very much. In terms of the lowest common denominator effect, I mean, I think we're just reflecting the reality that the rules were designed to be applicable to 28 extremely different geographies and economies, and so necessarily, given the way that they're designed, that only the things that fitted within the rules could go forward. They were necessarily going to be more restrictive than the kind of more permissive regime that we're moving to now, that's just applicable to the United Kingdom. Clearly there's far more flexibility available under the scheme as proposed. And the reality of that flexibility is, of course, going to be completely governed by the regulation that's associated with it, and the guidance that's associated with it, and the confidence that the public bodies have in bringing forward their own subsidy proposals within that. So yes, absolutely, the Subsidy Control Bill replacing the state aids regulations is an opportunity that we're excited and optimistic about. though obviously this has to be caveated in that it's also dependent on the resources that we have available to us from either of our governments, speaking from the perspective of local government. In terms of an example, I'm probably struggling actually to find an example that would be appropriate to really illustrate the point. I mean, I certainly know from my own experience in previous employment, I actually worked for Highlands and Islands Enterprise administering a small scheme. So I have some experience off the state aid regulations as they applied. But coming from an island community, we often ran into the situation that we'd love to have applied a subsidy that would have not distorted the common market, would not even distorted the market in Caithness. I come from Orkney, but because the rules as drawn up were more appropriate to land-based geographies, the lack of distortion wasn't really recognised. I mean that's a small and very specific example, but you know, if you wish, we can come back to you with more specific, larger examples.
Yeah, no, that's fine. Thank you very much, and very helpful. And yeah, as you say, whilst the guidance is one thing, the money to the resource behind it will be, I'm sure, a subject of debate for many years to come. Thank you for that, Professor Fothergill, on the consequences of the not signing up.
Yes, if I could, and let's go back absolutely to basics here. Subsidy control or EU state aid rules, these are a good thing. We have to be aware all the time that this is public money being dispersed to private sector companies. There is a cost to all of this. But at the same time, you know, if subsidies are used in a measured, targeted way, they can help deliver, you know, objectives that we'd all wish to achieve, you know, more R&D, more training, more investment and growth in less prosperous regions, the pursuit of the green agenda, et cetera, et cetera. So there is a role for subsidy control. We do need a system of this sort. Now, I use the words free-for-all in my written submission as being the horrible alternative. Let me just explain what that alternative might look like. I mean, firstly, everybody be operating in darkness, not knowing what they could or couldn't do. I mean, secondly, it would open the door to all sorts of backdoor political lobbying and favouritism. I mean, those with the best connections, the loudest voice would be best placed to get the most money. And it would also open the door to subsidy wars, which I mentioned earlier. You know, one part of the country trying to outbid another part, which is then, you know, and the subsidy gets bid up and up and up. So, in principle, subsidy control is a good thing. I'm not I never have been a great serious critic of the EU state aid rules. I mean, they were very useful, but it is undoubtedly the case that now we're moving away from the EU rules. We do have the opportunity to do things rather better, particularly at the edges. But we mustn't throw that opportunity away not having, you know, some of the detail in there that really makes a whole system properly operational. Subsidy control good, free for all bad.
Thank you very much. I don't have any further questions. I don't know if Professor Bell or George Peretz have anything to add.
No, I broadly agree exactly with what Steve just said.
Thank you very much. That's all, convener.
Thank you. I'll move on to Colin Beattie to be followed by Jamie Harper Johnson.
Thank you, convener. I'd like to look at the implications that have been highlighted by HIE about the lack of a definite commitment to an assisted areas map. Now, the importance of, I'd like to ask the panel what the importance is of having this assisted areas map and how it should be developed. And also, what are the implications if we don't have one? And I'd like to ask Steve Fothergill, who I know has a close interest in this, to perhaps respond first.
Yes, thank you, Colin. I'll do my best on this one. Let me kick off by saying that we had an assisted area map long before the UK joined the European Union. I mean, the history of assisted area maps in the United Kingdom goes back to the 1930s. And we've always used an assisted area map as an important tool of regional economic development. It's about, you know, targeting, helping to target investment by private sector companies in the places, the less prosperous places that most need that investment and the new jobs. And it's been a very, very useful tool of regional economic development over the years. It's brought, you know, tens, hundreds of thousands of jobs to the less prosperous parts of the country. It's enabled, you know, some of the less prosperous parts of Scotland and indeed the rest of the UK to attract inward investment that might otherwise have gone, you know, abroad, indeed. Now, the Subsidy Control Bill, soon to become Act, doesn't specify that we should have an assisted area map in future. There again, it doesn't rule it out. It's hard to see, however, how the UK government can meet its objective of, you know, pursuing levelling up, which I interpret as meaning bringing the less prosperous areas, you know, closer up to the national average. It's hard to pursue, to see how it can pursue that objective without incorporating, you know, some measure to favour investment more and public support for investment more in some places rather than others. And if you don't have an assisted area map, the honest you know, outcome, the danger is that you end up treating, you know, let's say Kilmarnock no more favourably than you treat Kensington, or Sutherland no more favourably than you treat Surrey, which really gets us no nearer to the objective of, you know, helping the less prosperous areas. You know, it's a tool. It's a tool. It's not the only tool that's brought economic development, but it's a very, very useful tool if we're really trying to target development in the less prosperous parts of the country. At the present point in time, under the old EU map, or, well, I'm not quite sure whether it's still in force. I presume it's no longer in force now. Around about a quarter of the UK population had assisted area status, was on the map. In Scotland, it was 41% of the Scottish population. I think if we were moving to a wholly UK-driven map, we could increase those percentages quite a bit to reflect the, you know, quite widespread extent of disadvantage. It wouldn't be unreasonable to push it to a 60 or a 70%. I'm sure in Scotland, but we do need that mechanism in there to try to target investment in the places where investment is needed most. That's the logic behind an assisted area map.
But if Westminster decides not to produce an assisted areas map, how are we going to determine the areas where that level of aid should be directed?
Well, in those circumstances, there'd be no rules, you know, stopping public sector bodies giving, you know, as generous a subsidies in Surrey, let's say, as in the less prosperous parts of Scotland. I mean, you would lose that facility to support the less prosperous parts of the country. You know, you would be actually working against the objective of levelling up.
I think David Bell wants to come in at this point.
And speaking from Sutherland, I would say, well, there's the issue of how you determine assisted areas or not is a highly contested area. And we've actually had some schemes drawn up that have been associated with some of the funding that's gone around recently, like the Community Renewal Fund, the Levelling Up Fund, and it was done without much consultation by MHCLG, and that implicitly, or not implicitly, explicitly, allowed certain parts of the UK preference in the bidding rounds over other parts of the UK. And one of them, I'm sure that Highland was on the same level as London City, which did seem a bit unusual. So there, with these kinds of now of assisted area maps, there's the issue of who gets to decide the map, and what indicators do they use to determine the map. So GDP has been a very common measure used by the EU for many years. Of course, now the Scottish Government is also putting an emphasis on well-being as part of its overall objectives. What that can do, if you end up with lots of indicators and not much clarity about who's making the decisions, you can end up with massive disputes. So you need some kind of mechanism that if you are going to design a map, and I'm not saying that you shouldn't, because you might, you don't want to, well, one thing, you might not want to spread your funding too thinly, but if you're going to do that, you've got to have a mechanism that will be robust in order to do that. And you should also maybe bear in mind that sometimes that not all a subsidy might necessarily be area based or place based, although there's a strong case for that. Some might be industry based, and so you would try to support a particular industry irrespective of where it was actually located, because perhaps that supported your net zero objective. So you've got that, for example, in Grampian, an area that was certainly until recently very prosperous, but probably an area that one might well want to support because it has huge potential as far as promoting the net zero objective.
You've questioned the criteria that could be used in order to determine an assisted areas map. Surely we've got templates that were in use before, or even the EU template.
I think the thing probably to do is to do something pretty simple. The more you complicate it, the more you end up inviting conflict, I suspect, over decisions. And the EU has used GDP per head and the threshold level of that for many years. That would certainly be a proposal that would be worth arguing about.
I think Stephen Heddle wanted to come in.
Reasonably passionate about this, actually, though I probably can't do the justice to this issue that Steve Fothergill and my colleague Dr. Passos Vidal did in their submission to the Commons Inquiry, which addressed this point very well. But the obviously COSLA, in as one of our amendments, we proposed a definition for assisted areas being an area awarded subsidies to stimulate additional investment, economic activity, to compensate for severe limitations in attracting and maintaining economic activity. So in doing so, we accept that there's regional disparities, and it would seem reasonable to map that so that the intervention can be targeted in a transparent way. I think the idea of levelling up without a assisted areas map could lead us to a situation where we're levelling down and we have a lowest common denominator situation. If we don't have a means to achieve the levelling up agenda, to achieve territorial cohesion, as it was known back in the EU days, And the, you know, associated with that, I notice in the submission from the Law Society of Scotland that they make reference to Article 174, which made specific reference to islands. And you know, I speak as an islander here. It wasn't just islands; it was islands and areas of economic disadvantage. And that helps provide elucidation or a definition around assisted areas. Steve Fothergill said the assisted areas isn't a construct of EU, it's something that's been on the go for almost 100 years. Indeed, it could be argued that it was something that the UK foisted upon the EU. We accept that the assisted areas maps for the EU perhaps weren't perfect. That doesn't mean to say that the UK could not develop a better one, because we certainly have the available data to do so. It got almost down to street level in terms of economic data. So the quality of the data and availability of the data is not the issue. It's the arguments would come around what the indicator should be as to determining what the economic disadvantage would be. GDP is always chosen because it's the one that everybody uses. In the past, or myself arguing for the Regional Connectivity Index, I don't think we'd want to specify anything today as being better, one being better than another. I think the idea of a assisted area map would certainly be beneficial to aid in transparency and avoiding the accusations of pot barrel politics that's associated with the pilots for the levelling up fund. And indeed, it would help us in our potential arguments in the future with the European Union around the degree of consultation and systematicness of the schemes that we're proposing, the rationale for the schemes, because you know, I anticipate that this will happen.
Do you agree that the point that was made that the Highlands are on the same status as London? I don't know if I've misinterpreted that, but it seemed that there was in this levelling up process, the Highlands were put in the same level as London. Is that, Steve, you're shaking your head there. Maybe you can clarify.
A number of things going on here. First, could I just make the point that if we do have an assisted area map in future, it does not mean to say that all subsidies have to be shoehorned, you know, within that map. I mean, you can have certain sorts of subsidies that you can do in some places rather than others. It would not preclude, spending more widely across the whole of Scotland, the whole of UK, for example, on green initiatives. Second point I would like to make is that, the Community Renewal Fund, the Levelling Up Fund, the selection of priority areas, which the Westminster government engaged in for both of those two funds recently, was deeply flawed. And you know, if Highlands and Islands was treated in the same way as large parts of London, then you know that was really quite wrong. But the experience of developing and using an assisted area map in the UK has actually been quite positive in the past. The key to getting a successful map is consultation. Asking about what is the best principles, you know, consulting on the draft map. Now, the maps that we have operated within under EU rules were largely, but not exclusively, drawn here in the UK and within a framework set by the EU, but they were drawn here in the UK. And through that process of consultation, we basically arrived at something which was, you know, broadly acceptable to most people. Now, not everybody got on the map who might have liked to have got on the map, but it was not a huge source of dispute and contention once it was in place. And I'm sure we could go through the same process again here in the UK if the UK government was willing to engage, one, in having a map, and two, in consulting in drawing up the map.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Beattie, I'm afraid I'll have to make progress, and Jamie Halko-Johnson is interested in questions in the same area. I'll move over to Jamie. We do, the initial time, I think the panellists were advised was 11 o'clock. I do have three members who still wish to come in, so I hope the panel are content to remain with us for a bit longer. But I'll invite Jamie Halko-Johnson in.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I'll keep mine brief. I've got one question and one supplementary, so I'll start with the supplementary to the last one. If I can put it to Councillor Heddle, it's good to see another Orcadian on the panel again. I hope that will continue as well. I was just wondering, on the basis of the engagement side and the consultation side, obviously the Scottish Government have a position. We've got the Minister coming in, I think, next week. What consultation has there been with COSLA or with Orkney Islands Council and the local councils in Scotland on this bill and the Scottish Government's response?
In terms of the formal consultation, so we've been involved in a degree of discussion with the UK government. I think this is a level of consultation that isn't formalised, and this kind of gets us back to the point that as we develop the guidance and the schemes that's associated with, would certainly be beneficial to actually have the degree of consultation that is formalised. And again, this is the substance of two of the COSLA amendments. In terms of the discussion with the Scottish Government, I'm sure there's been extensive officer discussion, political discussion between myself and the Scottish Government. It's largely in this forum. Certainly, it would be as COSLA would be happy to discuss this further with the Scottish Government going forward. We can always consult better, we can always confer better, and be happy to facilitate that from my perspective.
Okay, thanks very much, Stephen. Can I ask a question then of firstly Professor Bell and George Peretz? We've seen hundreds of millions of pounds of Scottish Government money and support, both directly and through loans going to a number of different companies over the last year, to name a few, obviously Prestwick, GFG Alliance, and others, Ferguson Marine. And one of the issues that's been raised time and time again has been scrutiny of these particular agreements and transparency. I was just wondering if you could advise how this new bill might impact on scrutiny of deals like these going forward. Could it impact on these existing deals, such as those I've mentioned, given that there will still be further support either agreed or likely to be agreed for some of these particular organisations? And do you think greater oversight, perhaps within the bill or to be included within the bill, is important? And if I can go to, as say, Professor Bell first, then to George Peretz.
So I would defer to George Peretz on the issue of whether these deals might be referred. My guess is that there probably might be grounds for doing so after the bill is passed. In terms of the principle, I do agree that greater scrutiny. Because you will always have some things that don't work. This is not a riskless activity in which to engage, but there are always grounds, given that it is public money, it's taxpayers' money, that these schemes should be fully scrutinised and a case made as to how these fit within some overall industrial or economic strategy, it seems to me.
Thank you. And to George Peretz?
Yeah, I'm in no position to comment on any of those particular schemes that you were in measures that you were talking about. But I think I made two points. One is that the bill does contain provisions on transparency. That's a subsidy database on which all subsidies and all subsidy schemes have to be recorded. The precise information that's going to have to be placed on those on that database is going to be determined by regulations made by the Secretary of State. But in principle, there's provision for quite detailed information to be required to be put on the transparency register. And until that information is placed on the register, the time limit for challenging a subsidy or subsidy scheme doesn't begin to run. So there's some incentive for the public authority to get moving and put the information on the database. So there should be, in principle, access to information by third parties, anybody who's interested, as to exactly what has been given to a particular company and why, and other information about that, which is obviously a good thing. So but precisely what is going to go on the database remains to be decided by the Secretary of State in regulations. One concern I have, though, is this, which is that one issue that very often arises out of projects of the kind you are talking about is whether actually it's a subsidy at all. Because quite often what a public authority says is this isn't a subsidy because we are simply giving a loan or support on market terms. Under the old state aid regime, that was known as the market in economy investor principle. It's got an equivalent under the bill. I forget the clause number off the top of my head, but the bill itself makes it clear that if a public authority is behaving as a privately owned bank would behave in terms of giving a loan on market terms or investment on market terms, then that is not a subsidy. The problem is quite often that the dividing line between the question of whether a public authority is really behaving as a private investor would is not free from argument. And you can have experts reaching genuinely different views on that question, depending on what assumptions they make. And it seems to me that there is at least a danger that in some cases public authorities may be rather too eager to say to themselves, well, actually, we're just behaving as a private bank would, and perhaps finding some expert to opine that, yes, they are behaving just as a private bank or a private investor would, in circumstances where that judgment is actually open to really serious question and perhaps ought to be made more public. Now, what the public authority will do in that case is they'll say, well, we're not granting a subsidy. There's nothing to go on the transparency database. And one of the problems, I think, with the bill is it's very unclear how that particular type of issue is ever going to be caught, because there's, in the EU regime, there's the European Commission, which acts as a sort of universal policeman. And if it thinks that, if somebody goes to it and says, well, we think something's been done, which is in fact a state aid and doesn't seem to have gone through the appropriate procedures, the European Commission can and will come down like a ton of bricks on that. And it's got powers in investigation. There's no equivalent here. So it's, unless you've got a quite active, engaged complainant that is prepared to try and dig and spend some money on getting information which won't be through the transparency base because it won't be on the transparency base, you may have a problem. Of course, there are other ways of getting information, of course, Freedom of Information Act, etc. But they do tend to be a bit slower.
But the concern that you have at the moment is there isn't that single body, as there would have been previously, to be able to determine, well, actually, you're not operating in a way any normal bank would be, because you're taking perhaps on a risk that a normal bank wouldn't take, or you're putting in terms that a normal bank wouldn't put in.
Yeah, now, I mean, because there isn't a universal policeman. There's no policeman here in the way that the European Commission polices the state aid regime. The CMA has no power to investigate of its own motion, something like this. What you'd be reliant on in the sort of case I'm talking about, where a public authority wrongly says, actually, this isn't a subsidy at all. We're just behaving as a private investor would. What you, if that assessment is wrong, then how do you catch it? Well, you're reliant on some third party, some private person acting as a, as a sort of as for its own interest, saying, hang on, we have objections to what is going on. We're concerned that what's being done is in fact a subsidy, doing a bit of digging, and then threatening to go to court. And then be prepared to take it to court. So you're relying on there being some private actor that's prepared to put up its own time and money to pursue this type of case. Now, in some cases, there will be. There'll be an obvious competitor that's deeply concerned about what's going on. But in other cases, there won't.
Thank you. That's extremely helpful.
Thank you. I'll now bring in Colin Smith to be followed by Gordon McDonald.
Good morning to the panel. Can I return briefly to the sixth principle in Schedule 1 of the Bill relating to competition and investment in the UK? And I also want to touch on Clause 18 of the Bill, which covers prohibiting relocation being a condition of a subsidy. I represent the south of Scotland, so there are many businesses based close to the Scotland-England border, and it's also obviously the gateway to Northern Ireland, so it's not uncommon for a business to relocate premises either side of the border, just a few miles apart. And as I said, Clause 18 of the Bill prohibits relocation being a condition of a subsidy. So can I ask the panel their views on the extent to which this clause and the whole sixth principle could impact specifically on businesses and support agencies close to the border? And maybe I'm conscious of time, so maybe I could put that question Mr. Peretz, as I know this is something he touched on in his written evidence, but if any other member of the panel wishes to come in on this point, I'm sure they'll indicate in the chat room.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, on Clause 18, it's my reading of it, and that is actually confirmed by the Minister's statement about what it means in the Public Bill Committee, is that it is actually fairly limited. It only applies in a situation where the granting authority says, for example, it is a condition of the money that we are giving you to locate this factory here, that you close down your factory somewhere else. Because if all the condition is we give you money and you build a factory here, that doesn't attract Clause 18, even if the economic reality is that because the factory is going to be built in the area of the granting authority, some other factory in some other part of the United Kingdom is going to be closed down. So you don't look at this through a lens of sort of economic reality, you just look at what the terms of the grant are. And it's only if the grant says you must not just only locate your factory here, but you must also close down the factory that you've currently got somewhere else, that it's going to be caught. Now, that it seems to me to be extremely unlikely scenario in practice. I mean, granting, there's no reason why a granting authority would ever insert that sort of condition, particularly if it knows that if it does so, it's likely to attract Clause 18. So I don't think Clause 18 is actually in the end particularly important. Indeed, I sort of rather wonder why it's there. The principle on trade and investment in other parts of the United Kingdom, I mean, one has to just stand back and remember what all that's about. What that means is that if an authority, say the the Scottish Borders local authority, decides to give some money to a company which is planning to locate some activity in Peebles, one of the things it does have to think about is what the effect of that may be, not just on its own area, but possibly on Northumberland. But it only, what it's required to do is to address its mind to that problem. It's got to think about what that effect might be. And then it's got to then look at the principles as a whole and say, well, bearing all of this in mind, is this a grant that we want to proceed with? And the answer might be yes or no. I mean, it could be perfectly rational to say, yes, we do accept that there's going to be a bit of an adverse knock-on effect in a neighbouring area. But when we're looking at everything in the round, this is still the right thing to do to achieve the public policy objectives that we've got. And if that reasoning is sort of pretty soundly based and based on proper evidence that's been taken and things have been thought about, then it ought to survive judicial review, which is the only, and scrutiny by the Competition and Markets Authority, which is the only, you know, sort of recourse that somebody who's upset about that can take.
Yeah, well, that's very helpful. I haven't seen any indication from any other member of the panel that if they want to come on that, or I'll maybe just move on to my second question then. I mean, related to issues around internal market displacement, in their evidence to the committee, Highlands and Islands Enterprise expressed concerns about how far and at what scale internal market displacement assessments are going to be needed, because this could have a detrimental impact on smaller community-based projects. South of Scotland Enterprise also highlighted that the current regime makes it easy to confirm an award is paid, but the proposals in the bill, especially Principle 7, makes a non-subsidy inclusion less likely unless that project is very clearly not commercial, but the vast majority of projects will always be commercial. So could I ask the panel what they believe the potential impact could be of the new regime on funding for smaller scale, innovative community-based projects? And maybe I could start with Councillor Heddle, given his experience in the Highlands. But again, if any other member of the panel wants to come in, I'm sure they'll indicate.
Thanks very much for that question. And with your indulgence, could I also just elucidate on my earlier response to Jimmy Hartwood Johnston regarding the consultation around the subsidy control bill? I should have said that, of course, I've been in continual discussion with the Scottish Government as officers on the wider issue of replacement EU funding, of which this issue is part, through the David Bales group looking at the replacement EU funding. So happy to make that point. On your specific point here on the impact that this might have on smaller schemes, particularly the requirement for internal market displacement assessments, this is indeed a concern, because it brings us back essentially to the capacity question and the capacity of the smaller bodies in the smaller areas to be able to respond to this requirement and to develop subsidies that can be applied to our communities. Now, I'm unclear, I have to admit, on how the subsidy control bill is going to apply to community enterprises and community projects, and I look forward to the guidance around that. We can look back to the increased thresholds, which the equivalent of de minimis, and the fact that this is greater is certainly welcome. But of course, they're still cumulative over 3 years, so we're talking about a £300,000 grant being applied over 3 years, which does not translate into a potentially vast subsidy. So it's absolutely an issue of capacity, potentially disadvantaging the smaller areas that need to develop these schemes in particular. And it brings us back again to our assisted areas map, which would enable such things to be progressed more transparently. Certainly, we're looking keenly to see what the guidance is going to say, because the way we've been progressing in the past, being due to the existence of things such as block exemptions, so some equivalent to that, or some streamlined projects that would be applicable to our areas, is essentially what we're relying on to be able to keep up in terms of developing the projects for our communities.
Thanks for that.
Jason, thank you. I'll now bring in Colin MacDonald. Sorry, Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, convener. I knew who you meant. Three very quick questions, given the time constraints we've got. The first one in relation to inward investment. Scotland's been very successful since 2014 in being the most popular area for inward investment outside of London. And given the earlier conversations we've had regarding the subsidy control bill, I'm just wondering what impact that could have on Scotland's ability to attract foreign investment, given they have to take into consideration competition impacts across the UK. Second point is we talked about how the Scottish or Welsh Government could approach the Secretary of State if they had concerns about subsidies being awarded elsewhere. Given that the Scottish Government has responsibility for economic development, by having to go to the Secretary of State, is that not undermining the devolved settlement? And lastly, membership of the CMA Subsidy Advice Unit, how can we ensure that the membership reflects the four governments in the UK, and should devolved governments have a say or an input into the membership of that unit? And can I go to Mr. Perez first, please?
Well, I mean, quite a few of these are sort of political questions, of course. I entirely see the case for saying that the Scottish government should itself have powers to refer to the Competition and Markets Authority, which is what we're talking about, in cases where the Secretary of State can. The way that amendments to that effect were put forward in the House of Commons by, I think, both the SNP and by the Labour Party spokesman on the Public Bill Committee, they were voted down. The government's position on that is that because this is a reserved matter, it's entirely appropriate for these powers to be reserved to the UK Secretary of State, acting, as they say, in the interests of the whole United Kingdom. And their position is, well, in a case where the Scottish Government did have such concerns, it could go to the Secretary of State, and the Secretary of State, we are assured, would take those concerns very seriously. I mean, whether you accept all of that or not, seems to be essentially a political judgment. As to the Competition and Markets Authority appointments, yes, that's confined to the Secretary of State. Again, the point made by the Minister when amendments to the effect that the devolved governments ought to have a hand in appointments to the subsidy advice unit was to sort of repeat the line that this was a UK reserved competence. But that it did add that the CMA, as you probably know, does have now fairly sizable offices in Edinburgh and in Cardiff, and I think in Belfast, but certainly in Edinburgh and Cardiff, and that it would be, I mean, as a matter of practice, I'm sure the CMA will recruit people with, to those offices, with some eye on the, on the politics of this, and think about its who it puts on the, who its staffing and so on, and will engage with, and I'm sure it will engage with the devolved governments. But whether that is enough is again a political question.
And do you have any concerns about Scotland's ability to attract foreign investments projects into Scotland?
Well, I don't see that Scotland's, I mean, its ability to do that was always constrained in the old regime by state aid rules. Under the new regime, it will be controlled by the subsidy control rules. These are, in some respects, as we were saying right at the beginning of this session, make it easier in some ways for the Scottish Government to do that. It can reach a view applying the principles as to whether the investment is, very broadly, in the public interest, achieves a public policy objective, is value for money, isn't getting somebody to do something that they would have done anyway, all these tests that one has in the principles, all of which are sort of good public policy tests. And provided that the Scottish Government comes to the conclusion that, yes, all these, we're happy that the principles are all complied with, it can go ahead and give the money. And it, unlike the old regime, it doesn't have to, wait for potentially for either conform to the block exemption regulations, which could be quite constraining, or wait for the European Commission to approve it, which could take some time. It can just go ahead and do it. And if there's then a challenge, it can defend that. But if the challenge is on judicial review grounds, which makes it much easier to defend against that sort of challenge. I think it'd be hard to make the claim that it necessarily made it harder for the Scottish Government to attract, to take measures to attract investment to Scotland. I think there are pluses and minuses.
Okay. Professor Fothergill?
The first two of Gordon's points about inward investment and about potential concerns about subsidies elsewhere and how that might fit in. I think the way forward here is to get an assisted area map in place, because a key tool in delivering inward investment to the places that you need the inward investment is being able to offer bigger subsidies in some parts of the UK than in others. And that's precisely what the assisted area map has done. I mean, in Scotland, it's been operationalised through the regional selective assistance scheme operated by Scottish Enterprise, for example. It's the tool to make sure that you get inward investment where you need it. It's also the tool to police what everybody else does in the system, because in the absence of an assisted area map, you know, there's nothing to stop the most prosperous parts of southern England chipping in with as generous a financial offer as someone in Scotland might offer. So get the map in place, and all of that will be easier. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks very much. Don't know if anybody else wants to come in on that. No, if not, that's me, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. McDonald. Can I just finally ask, Mr. Perez, in one of the answers, the recent answer said it was quite a political question. I suppose this one is. We have the minister in front of us next week, and in recommending that we don't approve the legislative consent motion, the minister has said the first concern is the sweeping powers of the Secretary of State, which ignore the devolution settlement and do not grant the equivalent powers to Scottish Government and other devolved administrations. I'm wondering if the panellists feel that is a fair assessment of the bill, given the discussion we've had this morning. Could I maybe ask Professor Bell to comment first of all? If you take some of the you could argue there's some hyperbolic language in there. If you were to strip that out, do you agree with the underlying concern that's been expressed by the Scottish Government?
Well, I mean, I think it reflects perhaps frustration at the lack of detail here, and you know, the lack of scheme or lack of a sort of pathway to developing schemes and fast stream schemes, and how other bodies other than the UK minister might be consulted on all of this. And I guess there's a level of frustration associated with all of that, and on issues, for example, like, you know, the role of the CMA and its, you know, it has got a presence in Scotland, but it's not entirely clear whether it will, whether the how responsive it might be to anything other than UK ministry. In terms of the of its interactions with different parts of the UK, the lack of the assisted area map we've talked about. So I suspect that, you know, part of the reason for the frustration is to do with the lack of detail that we've been speaking about this morning, and that it appears that the Secretary of State may be able to fill in at will post the passing of the Act, and that might be detrimental to Scotland. It possibly might not, but being in a state of uncertainty clearly might make one defensive about it.
And do you, finally, do you have a view on the previous question that Gordon MacDonald asked, that Mr. Perez responded to, this issue around the asymmetric balance of power when it comes to making complaints to the CMA? And I think what Mr. Perez said is that the UK government would argue that they will take forward issues in the best interest of the UK as a whole, but the concern is that they will have a focus on English subsidies, and there's no then equivalent power for Scotland or Wales to make representation if they're unhappy with allowances, sorry, awards that have been made in England. But the defence of the UK government appears to be, we will act in the interests of the UK and nobody should be concerned about this. Is that an is that the correct understanding of the situation?
That's my understanding, and I guess again, if there is a degree of scepticism about that, then whether that's just, I can't comment whether that's justifiable or not, but it would seem to me that there has to be possibility for the devolved administrations to have some recourse if they feel that activities in England are undermining their competitiveness or their own markets.
Thank you. Councillor Heddle, you've indicated you would like to come in before we finish.
Thanks. I mean, support the statements that Professor Bales made there. And in the absence of any detail at present, of course, any of the devolved administrations or public authorities are entirely entitled to be circumspect about what might happen. I think in this discussion we've all been fairly united in saying that absolutely we need better consultation, we need better co-production of the way that this is taken forward, and to get the best guidance, to get the best assisted areas map, and to get the best implementation of the new subsidy control regime. Yes, absolutely, we should have more input from the devolved administrations and local government and other public bodies as appropriate. And as to how what form that might take, well, absolutely, I would say that it would seem sensible that these organisations should have input into the subsidy advice unit, should also have input into the CMA. And the idea that the devolved administrations have the ability to call in schemes seems not unreasonable. The ability to veto such proposals, I can't see that ever happening. But I think, to come back to the point, for the best guidance, the best map and the best implementation, we need to have the buy-in and shared responsibility for the way this regime goes forward, and that requires measures as previously outlined.
Thank you. Mr. Peretz, you wish to come in. And could you maybe, Councillor Heddle did mention the issue and ability to veto. Could you maybe comment on that as well? I know you've previously commented on the asymmetric power issue.
The point I was going to make is that, in a sense, the pass on all of this was going to say sold, but that's not the right word, because the devolved governments all resisted it quite strongly, was taken by the Internal Market Act, which made subsidy control a reserved matter. And before that, the position was almost certainly that it wasn't a reserved matter. I mean, it just wasn't listed in the list of reserved matters, probably because, as a member of the EU, it would have been slightly pointless to do so. It wasn't even a UK competence at that stage. In a sense, what we're seeing is the working out of a legislative step that was already taken in the Internal Market Act. And it's just a logical consequence of that is that UK, it is a UK competence, so the involvement of the devolved governments is necessarily somewhat reduced.
Thank you, that's helpful. I'd like to thank all the panellists this morning for providing their time and their expertise. That's been much appreciated. We'll now move into private session for the remaining item on the agenda.